Is this thing on? Uh-oh, I need to set up what the stream is. Content? No. This. And. Oh, how do I modify these things? Nope. You'd think I would have worked out how to use computers by this point. Unless I just go to my channel. It's me. We're live. Edit. Does this sometimes? Aha. Okay, what are we doing? We're doing some Conjure hacking. Open source hacking, let's do this. Yeah, let's go with that. And science. And I don't think I'm going to tag anything because I don't think that matters. Correct category this time. Okay. So that's rendering. Send out a link. I thought I'd set up the keyboard cam so you could see how much coffee I had left, an important metric. And more importantly, what buttons I'm pressing. Okay, so that's live. Let's go and drop this over on another desktop. Okay, go there. And if I get the channel manager up, wherever that is. Should we get to see the chat and stuff? Create a dashboard. Is that the one? Yeah, that's the one. Oh, it's a real mystery using this stuff. Let's see if there's any tweeters. My phone there. It's really weird that Twitch doesn't seem to load on this laptop properly. It might be all of the ad blocking software I have. I do need to give it a hard refresh a few times. Okay. Is the Twitch page up? I can see the chat now. And I see a follower. Awesome. Cool. Awesome. That's all I need. Just mess with this setup a little bit more before I really dig in. I was seeing if I could rotate this. Does that look weirder? Maybe that looks weirder. I'm thinking flip the desk cam around and also center to screen, center horizontally. No, that's not what. Ooh. Hang on, my desk is moving around. Go, 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 go. Come on, and I want to crop it as well, which I think I can do. Can I crop it? Transform. No. Maybe not. Maybe I won't bother with that part. Yeah, that'll be fine. That'll be fine. The chat module is not loading. Cool. Let me give it another refresh. So I still can't see chat messages, and I think because of the nature of Twitch, they are gone forever unless I see them straight away. All right, I think it's connected now. Cool, yeah. Alrighty then. Where do I even begin? And I hope this is picking up the correct mic. Yes, it is. Great. I need to pick something to do. I hadn't decided ahead of time. And my normal approach is, I've got some fresh beans. I just opened the packet. It smells amazing. My normal approach is to go through the issues, and every weekend at the moment, just because I don't have the energy during the week to maintain open source, pick something, usually a bug before other things, like stuff that's broken really gets to me, especially this one. Like, if anyone can solve this, I'll love you forever. Like, it's, I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to work this one out. It's like a bug in Lua JIT, specifically on ARM chips, and specifically inside Neovim. So it's like a combination of Lua JIT inside Neovim on ARM. I don't own an ARM device. I suppose I have a Raspberry Pi, but like, to reproduce this, it's going to be a bit of a journey. And I'm not sure if I'm up for that. I wonder if I can get, hang on, if I do Twitch on my phone as well. That will make sure I don't miss things. But yeah, I don't know how I'm going to ever work this one out. It's just like, there we go. It's far too specific for me. And there's no reproduction steps. It's basically just, sometimes when I open Neovim, it throws this error. So I'd love to fix that one day, but I have no idea if I'll ever be able to do it. And then the rest of this is just, I mean, I don't know if you've ever looked through this list, if you use Conjure, but some of these are just add support languages, just notes. Some of them are things people have wanted for a long time, and I've had notes for, and I've transferred over to here because I used to have like a hidden to-do list. Now I thought I'd keep it public. No, I didn't do that. So this is something I could actually do today. This one and LFE. I had somebody email me and say they wanted Lisp flavored Erlang support, and they were willing to do it. But I'm also thinking I might be able to do it for them because I don't think they would be offended too much. I think they can do it, but I can save them the time and just give them the tool, and then they can extend it and still contribute to it. So we could do Scheme and LFE. Python will be fine one day. Some integration test suites could be good. This one, didn't I release this? So there might be something I need to release. Let's just check. Let's go... Yeah, you know what? Let's do it in the terminal. Much better. So pull roll up to date. Let's make sure my aniseed is up to date because I'm using local copies of my plugins. Cool, up to date. And because I commit my Lua, my like made output. Something changed. What changed? I was gonna say things don't need to be recompiled, but this one clearly did. Oh, interesting. Well, I hope everything still works. I mean, so when I run make, it runs all the tests. So this is in aniseed, and the tests are running fine. So let's give that a commit. Should be fine. Should be fine. Like, that didn't actually change the compiled output of a... aniseed, so I'm fine by that. Wonder what happened there. And I usually use lazy git as my kind of porcelain. Wait, is this? Oh, this is all on develop. Ah, all this yellow stuff is stuff I need to publish. Hold on. Is this up to date? Oh. Okay. Ah, okay. It was released. Good, good, good. Let's go back to Conjure. I can also do that to get around them. I keep forgetting. And what do I want to do? Want to itch my nose. I want to check this master branch. I tried renaming this to main and it broke so much. Like, it broke so many tools and so many people's local setups, and it's such a shame. Like, it's so encoded that if I want to change the branch name, I would have to leave the master one there because it breaks everyone's Neovim. Like, every time they update the plugins, if I rename the branch and master no longer exists, all these plugin managers don't know about default branches changing. Like, that's not a thing, or hasn't been a thing up until recently. And yeah, it broke everything in really weird ways. So that was a big whoopsie on my part. But it would be good to do that one day. I want to get away from master as well. And it's a nice shorter name. It's just better in every way. What's I can do? So let's check whether there's anything here. Ah, yeah, keep alt. And so we've got two new commits on develop right now that I could release as well, which we can do today. Add a failsafe to replace backslash enemy. Yeah, somebody found a situation where they couldn't reproduce it, but it was like a backslash n, a new line, was slipping through and trying to display in Conjure's log. And you cannot do that in Neovim. You have to like explicitly tell Neovim, hey, display line one, line two, line three, line four, line five. You can't give it one single string with new lines in it. It will choke and explode and give you an error. So you have to replace all those new lines and split those strings into multiple strings, which I thought I do everywhere. But there's apparently one case that nobody can reproduce but has happened once. So it's extremely rare where something slipped through. And now I've got a failsafe here. So if you see this kind of like this character return character, it's something has slipped through. And really, if you spot it, let me know because that means you found the place that new lines can slip through. That's a good coffee. And then this other change was to fix. Let's hop into Neovim. How can I explain it? I can explain it by doing this and evaluating something and going to here. It's Control 6 hops you between these things. So it hops you between your alternate buffer, alternate file. Yeah. So control hat hops between the alternate file. And basically this no longer does it. So I can go to another file. I mean, it counts my file browser as a file. But I can hop between those and it doesn't get kind of like overtaken by Conjure's log, which kind of makes sense. Like, that's what this issue was about. Whoops. It was just, yeah. So that's done. I'll merge that today. Let's pick something to do. This one was kind of fun, actually. This is kind of interesting, although it's very up in the air. So I think we do this, to be honest. I think we do this. This fellow was saying, I want to do go to definition, but if I'm on a remote machine, like so I'm nrippled into something that isn't my local device, the paths don't match up, which is what I put this in for. So this relative file root says that from on my local machine, my like directory, my repo is at like foo bar x. And on the remote machine, it's at like A, B, C, bar, quarks, X. So it's the same like subtree from here. That's your project in there on two different devices. Like maybe hosted inside a Docker container is kind of the idea. So like mounted inside a Docker container, but the path is different, but the paths below a certain point are the same. This setting basically allows you to tell you at what point, what route the files become relative. So you could put in, I can't even remember myself, which is part of the bad design, I guess. Yeah, so you can set it to your current working directory. So you would set it to basically this. You'd say my relative file root is this, and then it would spot that common ancestor on like go to definition and rewrite it so it would become I mean relative to your REPL. So you end up with like dot slash and stuff, and it works out at what point that should be done so that your file operations become relative across this boundary. And it means that if you do go to definition inside a Docker container, and the Docker container says, yeah, it's at this, the file's at this location, and the location doesn't exist on your machine, it only exists inside the Docker container. Conjure translates that to a relative path and then gives it to Neovim, and Neovim goes, oh, it's a relative path. I know how to find this. So it's just this weird like trick to get two file systems that are similar but not quite the same, but have a shared folder in them to sync up the paths. But that's not ideal. This guy had some good ideas, and I honestly think that this concept would be better. So what this would be a map in config that allows you to specify to string replacements, right? Just replace this with this in paths that you see. Maybe attached to the front of the path specifically. Maybe we don't want this to be at any point in the path, or maybe we do. So I feel like this would have to be a Lua pattern. We don't get regular expressions, we get patterns. So I think it'd have to be one of these, which is similar to a regular expression, to be honest. So, what would we do for that? Let's go into the config. We'd probably have some default config in here. So there should be a relative file root is nil. We could, I don't know, path substitutions maybe. What I'm thinking is that this will be what do they call them here? Path sub. Yeah, it's a sub, isn't it? Yeah. It's a substitution using a pattern. Path subs. Yeah, let's go with that. So what I'm thinking is that these will live side by side and they can kind of step on each other's toes. But if you're not using this one, I'll just deprecate it at some point in the future. So I think they can both live side by side, and one will just kind of supersede the other. Should it be subs? Subs feels too short. Maybe substitutions. Yeah, let's go with substitutions. I think that's better. So that's the config kind of sorted. I need to obviously document these things, but we now at least have a default map. So I think I can do let g conjure, not abolish, conjure path substitutions. No. Meh. It's not set, but I don't need it to be. That's fine. Ah, that is a map. Is that correct? Ah, no, this doesn't work how I think it works. So I think nil this as well. Yeah. That doesn't work how I think it works. So, yeah. Too much to explain right now, but trust me. So what can I do with that? Let's say I set that. I've got a local nvim file, lnvim fennel. and I use this to set some test things. So let's do like set nvim dot g dot. Oh yeah, I have completion now. I keep forgetting. I've got final completion. Nvim g dot conjure. Path substitutions. Oh my god. Substitutions. Yes, that is far too easy to typo. Let's go with subs. Otherwise, myself and anyone that tries to type this, oops, is going to be typoing it all the time. Okay, so path subs. I'm going to set it to, what's it going to be? It's going to be this table, right? So root m2, home tgeorge.m2, source amp dot. So my case, who am I? I'm Ollie. How about we replace Ollie with Ola Cal? It's wrong, but it's a change. Can I see this now? If I let this. Yeah, there you go. So now we've got a table stored inside there. And it's pretty cool that like this is a Lua table, but this is a Vim script map, and they just translate across each other perfectly. Cool. So we've got that value. Now, where do I do this translation? I think it's FS. I think last time I looked at this. So I kind of want to know everywhere that relative file root is used. So FS, documentation, config, FS, FS. Lua, FS, documentation, cool. Relative file root is only is only mentioned in the code here. Relative. Okay, so we got resolve relative to. Successively removes parts of the path to, oh, so this is just a generic version of resolve relative. Okay, so all of this will become irrelevant near enough. Who calls resolve relative? Someone's got to call it. Editor? That's not the only place. Yeah, editor and eval. So if I do fs.resolve relative. Test. So we've got editor, eval. Okay. So these two, these need to be, I need to wrap these in another function now. So these two functions are going to be the ones to do with the old idea of doing this relative file root. And I need another function that's going to kind of like run whatever it needs to. So what's this going to be called? That coffee is so good. What is it? It's like localized path, maybe? Correct path? Modify path? Substitute path? Modify path? Naming is the hardest thing, by far. Where's my dashboard gone? There we go. If anyone has any opinions as well, let me know. I don't know what this is called, because this is essentially going to be a generic function that, given a path, will correct it using config. It's just like, hey, file system module, correct things. Like, just make this path point to where I want it to go. Like, localize path. Yeah, let's go with that. It's better than resolve relative, I think. So there's only these two occurrences. There is when you ask Conjure to evaluate a file, it will do this localization to try and be like, hang on, what file system are we on? Oh, that's a point. Go to definition is one way. Okay. How am I going to explain this? Well, there's problems in my head, but how do I get them not in my head? So let's actually get those files back up. So editor and eval. So these are the two calls to localize path. Function that doesn't exist yet, but will. It will exist. The problem here is that no, I think they are okay. So the go to definition will say no, it's a problem. So this path here, when we say localize here, when we're trying to go to a definition, this path we're given will be a path on the remote host. So this is going to be the path from your Docker container. So a path that doesn't exist on your local disk. So if you tell Neovim to open it, it's going to be like, well, this just doesn't exist. Like, I don't have a slash app directory, and rightly so. And then this one is going to be path on localhost. So this is going to be the current path Neovim knows about. And you need to give that path to your Docker container, basically, and say, hey, eval this. Which means you have to go both ways. This isn't like an omnidirectional thing. So what I had originally was it, that was why I liked it, because it would make paths relative, and it meant that it would work both ways. Like everything became relative paths, which worked generally for me. Like, is that what this guy is kind of saying? No. He's saying if you get a root M2, it becomes T George M2. Which is fine. Like, that's kind of okay. And source app is actually dot. That's also kind of okay, but you also need to go the other way. You need to say, oh, maybe that is what he's. I think this guy's got a decent idea. I'm just worried it's going to be, in practice, it's going to be confusing because it's used in two places. It's used in a kind of remote to local and a local to remote. And I think that that's going to get pretty confusing, which is a shame. Also, if you don't have a terminal that supports ligatures, get yourself a terminal that supports ligatures. It's just especially for like Lisp-like languages, like it, yeah, it's so good. So maybe I do already have a decent approach to this. As you point out, it's only for the project route. It'd be nice if we wanted to do. No. Okay, so maybe it's a combination of both. Maybe I add this feature, and I also. Yeah, maybe they both have their own uses. Because I think for this guy's use case, let's actually think about this in reality. How would this work? Grab this, put it in here. Yep. So, can I eval that? Yeah, I can. It's valid. Cool. So we're saying root M2 becomes this other home directory. So that would be, that's the case of go to definition, right? So you're going to definition on some dependency, like on COJ HTTP, and it says, yep, here's the source file. It's in slash root slash dot M2 in your Docker container. And your Neovim is like, well, I can't see that. That's inside a Docker container. I'm not a savant. And you need to translate that to be your home directory, which also shares it because presumably you've mounted your .m2 into this Docker container. So you need to translate the path. Like the file exists, it's just the path is wrong because of this translation layer while you're talking to another machine. And it doesn't have to be a Docker container, it can be a remote host. You could be talking to your production or staging servers. So when the nREPL server gives you this path, gets replaced by this one. That seems all right. This one as well, if you do go to definition, it says source app, and you say actually it's dot slash. That's the same idea as my relative file root. The one it doesn't solve is where you say comma ef. Can I show that? Yeah, hang on. Hang on. I can show that. Let's get this one to have defn localize path. What is it? Let's just take all args and do resolve relative. For now, it's just like a rename of sorts. That file's not used. Okay. And what other ones did I change? Were there any others? I don't know if there were. Oh yeah, config, config. That one, let's quickly change, get rid of that line. Okay. Let's make everything, make sure it's all built. Cool. Oh, that rebuilt everything. Well, that's gonna be fun. It doesn't matter. Let's go to a Closure sandbox, bring up a REPL. Yep, connect. Okay, we have Basset Hound. So I can evaluate this, but if I do comma EF, the path it sends, I need to get the suffix. Oh, we can tell that it's an absolute path. So the path that we send to the mREPL is my absolute slash root to this. So if we're connected on a remote mREPL, then this isn't going to work because we're going to tell the mREPL to load a file from my local disk, and it just that doesn't work. And if I set relative file root, relative file root equals get CWD. Just that. See, that worked. And now the file path is relative. It's just dev, closure, source, dev, sandbox. So I think that the combination of relative file root, which works great, like I put a lot of thought into that. I don't want to toot my own horn, but like, I think it's pretty good. Like, it's a little hard to like your head around. But it handles like so many cases. And I could even like, maybe there's, I mean, I could make it a Boolean where it's like, just make things relative to my current working directory. But I feel like that's just a slight specialization of this example. We just set it to get CWD, I think that's easy enough. I think this should just be more widely known. When you're working on a, I need to document it more. When you're working on a remote host or in a container, the bare minimum, you should just set this relative file root to your current working directory, and then you get relative paths. And then I can do go to definition. That took me to the definition of def, which is out here. So this is the part that he's interested in. So I think this is what we can add support for. So I think we need both. And what we would do is if I was running this in a Docker container, you would get like, what would it be? That. And we want to replace it so it becomes home Ollie. That's kind of the change he wants to exist. Okay, I've got my head around it now. I got my head around it. So I go to fsfennel. We've got localized path. Is it localize? I'm not sure if it is. I'm not sure if it's localize. I feel like that's a bad word and I'm going to regret that. At least resolve relative will be kind of hidden away now. I didn't like those themes, really. Like, there's. Is that type put? There you go. Correct spelling. Going to go with localize because you don't know what you're localizing it for. You're localizing it for something. Either your machine or your remote machine. Oh, op from retweeted. Thank you. Yeah, let's go with localize. So we have our config. Oh, I can't open that one. Resolve relative. Do I do that first? I think what I'll end up doing is taking this. Oh, wrong button. Taking this path, because that's what it is. Let's not lie. Like, it's not a var args function, it's a single one. And what does this do? We're going to run a. Relative, oh no, apply the g conjure relative file root and g conjure path subs configuration to the given path. So it's kind of a combination, right? It's these two ideas. One is applying relative file root, the other one's going to be applying path subs. Resolve, no, it's not really resolve. Apply path subs. Yeah, let's go with that. For now, let's just return path. So what are we gonna do with this? We're gonna do, I think, just thread, you know. Slurp. Ooh. So we've got resolve relative and apply path subs. Think that first, because it might be able to do a path substitution and then resolve the final thing to relative. Oh, cool, spam. How do I get rid of that? Show mod icons, no chat appearance, deleted messages. I have no idea how. There you go. I can ban spam bots, but I don't know how to delete individual messages. I don't know if you can. Okay, so we're going to run that path through these two things and hope that none of them throw errors because that could be bad. What's this? Oh, apply path. Okay. Yeah, so load these, load these. Yeah, so we've got those two functions. So what do we want this to do? Let's get the config value first. So this is going to be like let. Let's make sure we're returning this. Let because we're editing Conjure live while I'm using Conjure with Conjure. So I'm editing the tool I'm working on using the tool. And if I break the tool, like if I break this function now, I then can't do comma EF. I can't eval files because it relies on this code. So it's quite a tight feedback loop. So let's get path subs, and it's just path. Subs and config again. There you go. So there's the config. So we're going to do this replace Ollie with Ollie call. And I need something in this let. So we're going to go into this let. And what are we going to do? We are going to do some G subbing. I think it will be a G sub. So this is probably going to catch somebody out at some point. But I think it needs to be a pattern. If it's not a pattern, I think you're going to get into situations where you're like, oh, do you? I don't know. I think you want to be able to express like whether it's the beginning of the string or not. Because you don't want false positives. So you want to be able to say hat slash root, you know, so that it doesn't pick up foo slash root. I think that's a fair assumption. Do I have aniseed core included? I do. So what I'm going to do is a dot kv pairs on path subs. That's going to give me a sequence of key values. And I'm going to a dot reduce and start with path on. I wrote all these functions, but I can't remember how they work. And I think I get ack, which is going to be path, and then this is going to be from pat and replacement. I think that's just like a dot print learn path pat rep. See what we get. Explodes. Unknown global in strict mode path. Why is that? Path, 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 path. Oh, of course, because this is a function. Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. Apply path subs to, I don't know, home, ollie, foo bar. It didn't print anything. Oh, no, it did. It did. Just printed to my messages. So path, yeah, that worked. Cool. I don't know why it didn't turn up in the log, but you know, whatever, I'll take it. So this reduce is going to reduce the pairs of replacements over this path. So what does this end up doing? This ends up being a. I would have no idea how to express this in Lua, like absolutely none. As soon as it's in Fennel, it's the same language, but like, just having a Lisp and also destructuring makes it so much easier. Like the destructuring in Fennel is great. It's just the fact that it like smells just close enough to closure that I don't need to really think about it is amazing. So I'm gonna do a G sub, pat rep. I think, and get rid of this one. Do that. Hey, first time. Awesome. So that replaced the ollie in there with ollie call. Now, if I go to my lmvim fennel, that's where I've got this config. Let's do like, I don't know, it has to be at the front of the string. Now, it didn't replace. Because it's not at the front of the string. Now home slash ollie. Leave it at that. Now it did replace. Ah, so this replaced. Oh, of course. I mean, yeah, that makes sense. Can I do? Oh, can I do? Can I do? Does this work? One. Is it backslash one? I don't know what the syntax is here. No. Sent one. Yes. Okay. Okay. Now we are cooking with gas. I think this is pretty cool. I think this is pretty useful. Yeah, I'm gonna have to really document like these are Lua pattern replacements. These are G subs. These are not just string replacements. Like, because otherwise it's too vague. If you do string replacements, I could say. Well, it's always from the front, but that's so restrictive. So you need to say it's a string replacement from anywhere in the string, but then that's too vague. So you need to make it patterns. You need to have this kind of expressivity so that you can express this kind of thing. Oh, that's really good. Oh, I'm happy with that. Fantastic. Oh, don't tell the TDD experts. Now I'm going to write my tests. So, what does a test look like? I should have written these tests before. please don't judge me. So I'm going to do diff test, apply path subs because I always name my test the same. T dot equals, so what was the test there? The only thing is I'm not passing the config in. You know what? Now I could. Okay. I'm almost out of coffee. No. So, when I tested the other one, I only tested the version that could take an argument. You know what? I can do that. There you go. Job's a good one. All good. Yeah, so now this one takes arguments. With the string being the first arg, yeah, I think that's about right. Really, what I've done is like a map of G subs. That's all it is. It's so simple. It's just a map of G subs, which I'm totally fine with. So, what do we expect to get? We expect home oracle foo to come from fs dot apply path subs. Make sure this is evaled. Yep. Apply path subs. The path is going to be home ollie foo, and the thing will be ollie for oracle. So simple mid-string replacement. Test this. All good. Yep, they're all testing okay. And then let's do one that involves like G sub stuff. So hat bar ollie. No, yeah. Hat ollie does nothing, right? Non-matches do nothing. Yep. About nil? Nil path subs does nothing. Because I don't want that to explode. Hey, that's. Oh, because I'm doing a dumb. There we go. You can't run your tests by evaluating them, Ollie. Cool. And let's do another one. Just a clever G sub one, like the one I showed earlier. Where was that? Can I steal it? No, it was in my other file. Never mind. Which was this one? Aha! G sub, what are they called? Regions? Capturing groups? Capture group replacement. Which then becomes slash home slash oracle. Yeah! All right, so localized path does the right thing now. Just got to document it, right? I've just got to document path subs. Yeah. Because of the way I built all of Anisey's functions, like KV pairs, if you give it AB, it gives you that. You give it no args, gives you that. You give it that, gives you that. Like it's just very nilly, nilpunny. It can just handle stuff not existing, which makes everything a lot more robust and closure-y, you know. I'm so used to closure where just I throw nil around everywhere and it's fine. Like, I don't worry about it. Want more coffee, but I do not need more coffee. Okay, so how do we document this? This is going to be a core Conjure feature, so it's going to be Conjure TXT. And let's go for relative var root will be under here. It is called gconjure path subs, right? Path subs, yes. If set, conjure will replace paths on go to definition as well as eval file. Modify. If set, conjure will modify paths on go to definition. I'm gonna quote them. Quote them so that you know that it's kind of a command. It's a thing you could do. If set, conjure will modify paths on go to definition as well as eval file. The path will be substituted using the keys of the path subs table and replaced with the values. Yeah. The path will be substituted using Lua's string.g sub function. The keys of the path subs map table are the patterns and the values are the replacements. Yeah, I think it's a bit better. So if set, conjure will modify paths on the on go to definition as well as eval file. The path will be substituted using Lua's string.g sub function. The keys of the path sub table are the patterns, and the values are the replacements. And then I will link to patterns. Lua pattern documentation. So an example. Think I'll take this example because this is good. How we can do this? Yeah, sure. That we. So root M2. Oh, what's that? That was an interesting error. Deoplete threw an error on getting some context. Huh. Fun. I think it was trying to. Oh, it was trying to look up paths in slash root, and I don't have a dot M2, and it threw an error and died. Fun. So I think this is a good example. And also hat oop, slash ollie, no, home slash foo and percent one. Yeah, let's do this thing as well. Because I think this is kind of interesting. gotta. How do I get out? Is it that? Yeah, it's really weird trying to get out of the code block. Okay, I'm going to go with that for now. This is kind of a power user feature. So I'm not too concerned about it being like super easy to use because it's something that will end up in like FAQs and stuff. And will be a recipe that people post around, I hope. So if set conjure will modify paths on go to definition as well as eval file, the path will be substituted using Lua's g string.gsub function. The keys of the path subs table are patterns and the values are the replacements. Lua pattern documentation, and then I show that like this is actually pattern stuff. Like you can do things with patterns here. This can be used when connecting to REPLs outside of your local machine or within Docker containers where the file system don't quite match up. Also see gconjure relative file root. Or see also. See also. And I'm going to do that for this as well. And spread these out. Because it's fine. See also gconjure path subs. Yeah, that's better. That's nice. So I think that's kind of that done. I don't know if there's anything else that needs to be done here. When was this 10 days ago? I like to respond to things like soon, like as quick as possible. I like it when I get a question and I reply within a minute or something. I wonder if it's surprising for the guy that, or the person that submitted the question, but I can't think of anything else that needs to be done there. It's annoying that every file has changed. Why is that? I can commit these separately. Let's get rid of that change because that's just not going to help. Let's test it as well. So if I go. No, I need to do stuff on a remote machine to test it. Think this will be okay. So we've got conjure txt, changes there. We've got path subs, editor, eval, fs. What were all these? Conjure client closure. Like, what changed? It's really weird. Sometimes when I update Fennel, like the compiler, just everything changes. It, just like this, just very slightly, but FS test, what am I looking for? I'm looking for specifically FS. You know what? No, you know what? Let's do it correctly. This is too confusing. Clear that. G reset dash dash Lua. No, G, oh, G restore dash dash Lua. All right. So what's different now? FS eval editor config. Conjure. Cool. Yeah. Let's commit these. Add path subs config and behavior and reference fixes 164. Oh, I've just realized you can see my password. If you're fast enough, you can work that out. I mean, that's a local GPG key thing. But yeah, that's a fun one. Didn't think about some elite hacksaw is going to slow it down, break into my house, get my GPG key. And then what? Sign some commits with it? I'm not too worried. Cool. Let's push that. Do I push that? No, I don't push that yet. Now we do a make, and it's going to do everything. Because. Oh, why? I just don't understand. Recompile the universe. Not sure why this is fine. Push. If you're not using lazy git, use lazy git. What's that? Oh, yeah. I get a notification from my Discord every time I oh, goodness, these. Every time I push, I get notifications that the builds ran and that there's new commits and that. Yeah, all sorts of things. So let's refresh this. So we now have this change here. Just pushed this feature to develop. It's under the G Conjure path subs. Hopefully this makes them nice and happy. Maybe they don't need it anymore, but it's still a good idea. I like the idea. Thanks, Tom George. Path subs. It's under the G Conjure path subs config, which can be found in H Conjure. Let me know what you think. Cool. Now, I will probably release it before I get feedback, to be honest. So this can be closed. This can be closed. Like, I may not have solved the solution magically or as magically as I like to with Conjure, but it's like the tools are there to get the solution, which I'm trying to do with a lot of stuff in Conjure right now. Like, provide the hooks you need to solve the really specific problems. Without me having to solve all of them, because some of the problems, if I solve them in one way, it breaks it for somebody else. So I'm kind of like stuck with some things, like this one, like options to auto clear the log. So then I put in an option to do this, and then somebody's like, "Well, I want to auto clear it in this way." So I had another option to do that, and then before you know it, you got like 10 Boolean flags that all do different things. So I'm trying to recommend and find ways to get like the behavior people want without adding Boolean flags all over the place. Because I'm going to have an explosion. I'm going to have like 50 flags that make everything behave subtly different, and suddenly everything is a buggy mess now that I can't change because there's so much Boolean logic going on. So the better thing is for me to expose events and hooks that people can use to get that really specific behavior ju that just they want in just the right way so they're happy. And I haven't got like a specific flag that I'm maintaining just for that one person. There's a few occurrences of that I'm trying to balance. Fun times. So these are dumb. Oh, sorry, I'm sniffly. Convert inline eval of a form into a comment and add result as a comment. So that I think I can do as well. Oh, make inline hard. This one I'm not so sure about, or even if I'll even do it. That was my idea, and I don't know if I want to anymore. Option option to auto clear log, ship asset function signature. And this one will be good, but kind of tricky. I think a few people wanted this one, and it's lower hanging fruit. I don't know how I would implement the mapping though. How will I describe this? So EC, some people are saying like E semicolon, at least in SpaceMax. This assumes semicolon is your comment indicator. And Conjure is polyglot, right? Like, it's not always a semicolon for a comment. So I can't rely on that idea, really. I can let people remap it to semicolon if they want to, but I don't think I want that as the default. I think EC would be pretty good for eval into comment. The problem is, it would just be your current form, and I don't know if that's okay by people or not. So what'd it look like? Oh, every time. Wrong one. So when I add a new mapping, it's in here. So I got eval marked form, eval replace form. It's kind of in the same realm as eval replace. It's like eval and comment form. Eval. Into comment form. I don't know. Maybe just eval comment form. Although, I know that's a different thing. So the other thing I was thinking of implementing today was where is it? No. Maybe it's not here. There we go. So this would mean if you try and eval the outermost form, like inside a comment, like comment +1, +2, +3, +4. So I can currently like eval on here, or what if I'm in like here and I want to evaluate that form. So I could do comma ER to do the root, but it does this, does the whole comment block. I basically want comma ER, like root form, from here to evaluate this, to stop at the level before the comment. Which is really tricky to do. Like, that's super tricky for me to implement because all I have is strings. I don't have this passed. I can't see the AST. Like, I have no data structure to work with here. So I don't know how I will do this at all. But it's worth a try. It'll be a cool feature because then you can go into these comments and just do comma ER and evaluate top level expressions, which would be pretty handy. So I'd like to implement that at some point. So I think eval comment form is good. That gives us a default. So you can replace that. Somebody can set this to E semicolon if they really want to. That's fine. I think this one is the more requested and interested one, to be honest. So how can I implement this? Because this is, it's actually pretty tricky, I think. It's pretty tricky. It's cool that Sotte, kind of worked out. This is what I want to see from people. I want to see people like creating their own mappings and stuff, and like connecting bits of Conjure together. I love to see this. This is great. Because I can't do everything. Like I'm one brain that has some power on weekends after coffee. Like I have very limited capacity, and I try and like work where it's most important, where I think I'm the only one that can handle these problems, but I want other people on the fringes to be handling their own problems using the tools I've kind of laid out ideally. Makes me very happy to see. So how's this going to work? Because I think how it was described is that if you had plus 1, 2, and you did comma EC now, you get 3 appear here. And then if you did it again, I think the next one appears here, which that seems. I don't know about that. I don't know. I think that was how they described it. Relearn the ability to display results of an evaluation beside the form of virtual text. Yeah, oh, there. That was what I added as Conjure. It'd be incredibly useful for composing results on the fly if the inline eval could also be converted into a comment, which would greatly aid in train of thought, REPL-driven development, demos, screencasts, and so on. It is noted that another popular editor built upon Emacs offers this feature too. Thus, having a bit more parity with that would aid people in transitioning across. A suggestion would be to use EC. Yeah. Is there anything in Quaterians right now? So I think that's how they recommended it worked. Cider eval into comment. See if anything turns up. I do want to fix this one someday. Let's just chuck a pair of eyes on it. I'm looking. I'm looking. And what's this? Was there an at here, or is it a conjure mention? I love that mug. Ah, oh, David, that's great. I want that. Instead, I have Firefly. What was this mention? How do I see it? Oh, there we go. Oh, so that was it. Yeah. Well, that was confusing. Nothing in Vim. Yeah. I spend quite a lot of time just keeping up with notifications. Code evaluation. Let's have a look. Comment. Cider print eval definite point. Cider p print eval last s expression. Evaluate the form preceding point and pretty print the result on a pop-up buffer if invoked with a. I mean, that's conscious eval, right? Like, that's the difference, I guess. One of the differences between Conjure and Cider is that this is already a pretty print. Like, just the log does a lot of those features that are separate. It's not better as such, it's just a different way of thinking about it. Like, I build everything around the log, and I think that works well. pprint eval last s expression. Evaluate the form preceding the point and pretty print the result on a pop-up buffer. If invoked with the prefix argument, insert the result into the current buffer as a comment. So prefix arguments are in Emacs. That's like control U before you do a mapping, I think. Does Vim have that? I mean, there's numbers. Like, you can do like 3 comma EE. Huh. I'm doing 2 comma EE. 3 comma EE doesn't do anything. That's really weird. What is that doing? Confusing. I'm not going to get anything from there, am I? So let's have a little look at the mapping documentation. I'm wondering if there's like a extra argument I can give it. So that all eval mappings can take a like, oh, and put this in our comment thing. Because the thing is with Conjure's evals, like the way I have it set up, so all evals go into the C register, but mine go into my default register. So if I eval, I can paste. Like eval, paste. Like the results are already in my register. So for me, that, and then like I can paste stuff if I need to. So it's I have less of a need for it because in my head I'm used to it, but I think a comment eval would still be good. Let's go back to mapping. So what is there anything here that's like a prefix? Is that a script? Map unique expression. Prefix? Buffer? No, wait. No. 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 Control U in Vim is a clear. Oh, this is a way to clear the command line, I think. Yeah, there's nothing here, really. Okay. So, what does that mean for me? I think I keep it simple, and I go with eval comment. So, you can't do, you know, a combination of, I want to do eval at marked form, and then have the result pasted. Which is kind of annoying. Could I do that? No, there's no convenient way. I was thinking you could do a mapping, like, set up the next eval. So you could do a mapping, like, comma, EC or whatever. And that didn't do the evaluation on its own. And then you did EE or ER. And that would do the eval and then append the result. But that's too many steps. It's too many things to think about. So I'm going to keep it simple. Eval comment form. So let's go to eval fennel. And there's marked form, which if you don't know how this works, let's show how eval marked form works. So 10, 20. So I can eval that on that point. I can mark it with MF. So now the F mark, I can go to it. So it's a normal Vim mark. But I can do EMF. And you see the 30 appeared next to that line. So I can eval at a distance. To be honest, that 30 should probably appear on this line, shouldn't it? I'm not going to be able to see it from off screen. Ooh. Yeah, there's no way to see unless you have the HUD up. Huh. Fun times. So it's basically going to be a mirror of marked form. So where do I set up marked form? Marked form is set up in mapping. So let's go to mapping. Eval marked form. Only these three occurrences. So let's grab these. Eval comment form. The phrasing doesn't make sense here. Like comment form that doesn't. Yeah, grammatically, that smells, but who's going to stop me? This is my internal code, and it fits the pattern, which I think is more important than anything. So eval marked form, grab that. Comment form. You're not evaling a comment form. You're evaling and commenting. So there's a difference. So what does this do? Actually, what we do is an eval current form. So where is current form? It's actually kind of like replace form. Ah. Yeah, it's just like replace form. So let's grab this one. Okay, and let's try it. Let's see if this works. I'm evaling as I go, so plus one, two. EC, oh, it does not. Definitely does not. Oh, because the buffer's not fresh. So let's give this a make and restart all the things. Eval fennel, comment form, and give this a plus one, two, comment EC. Okay, so we've got eval and replace. So comment form is currently eval and replace. And this is useful because it does a bunch of this setup. It does like, get me the current buffer at the time of the eval, because evals can take time. We do a eval in closure. That could take 5 minutes. And you have to be able to go back to, actually, I mean, you could start an eval in closure, delete your window and your buffer, and then Conjure will try and go back there to display stuff. That will cause an error. Unlikely, and I'm probably not going to bother to patch that up right now, but if you try and break Conjure, you could. It would carry on working, but it might display an error, you know. So, we extract a form. If I run extract form on extract form, we get the code for extract form, which is fun. So I wrote all this. This is all my own code that finds pairs of things. And when I have tree sitter support everywhere, I will just replace the internals of how this works with accessing tree sitter, which is very exciting. So if we can get a form, then we do an eval stir with the content and a range. Origin is comment form. Suppress the HUD. Do we suppress the HUD? Yeah. Yeah, we do. oh, I'm so glad Past Ollie did all these things. On result. So this is where it's going to be fun. If the line already ends in a comment, then we're going to want to create a new line. I can have a little coffee break in a bit. I've just realized I've been sitting here for an hour and 20 minutes. I haven't moved. My poor legs, they're going to wither away. So this currently does a replace range and then does go to start. This is just think. Okay, so we do a replace range and then we move because we're going to have potentially like move the lines around, because during a replacement, a single line could be replaced by 50 lines. So of course your cursor is going to fly all over the place. So I've handled that there. What does this do? Oh, that's the form to there. So it's not really replace range. We have the result. Okay. Let's go with a simple one for now, which will be if the current line is still the same. It needs to go after the form, doesn't it? It needs to go after this range. So when I do this, you see in the range we get an end. So that's a line and column number. So line 148, column 29. Whoops. Isn't it? Yeah. So line 148, column 29 is the end of this form. I need to jump to the end of the line after the end. So I need to jump to here and put the result in. Oh, that's fun. So it's going to be ignore the column, get the line of the end of the form, jump to the end, and check if there's a comment. If there is, insert a new line below this one with the comment of the result in it. Like, okay. I think before that, I'm going to take a 5-minute break. I'm going to make another coffee. I don't know if you can see my fancy mouse off screen there. Let's go tab new. BRB. 10. Yeah, less than 10 mins. Making brain fuel. Yeah. Make it nice and big. I'll be back in, less than 10 minutes, and let's implement this, and I'll probably finish up after that, maybe do a release, just release new features. Okay, back in a bit. I'm back. Okay. Whee! I have a fresh cup of coffee. Could tweet again. Maybe. I think people realized how boring this stuff is. And why I have to muster up the energy on a weekend to spend hours thinking about it. Let's refresh this. Okay, Twitch is just not loading for me. It's weird how broken it gets. Huh. Is it my ad block? Let me just try turning it off. I don't think it is. I think Twitch just doesn't work. Even with AdBlock completely off, I just can't get it to load properly. Just some of the modules don't load. So I am pretty convinced it just doesn't work very well sometimes. Oh well. Oh well. Does not matter. So where am I? Okay, so origin comment form, range, code, suppress HUD. I think this is fine. The question is how I'm going to edit these lines because what do I have access to? Set lines? Yeah, so I have set lines. So basically I can set chunks of lines to be different things. Sorry. Just change the title slightly. I'm trying to work out how I'm going to do this because Vim doesn't let me like. I can't just do the normal thing where if I was in Vim and I was like, I want to put a comment at the end of the line, I do shift A space semicolon foo escape. Like that is all fine and dandy, I think, for some Vim script plugins and for your own mappings. But the thing you have to think about with these evals is the point that this happens and the point that this callback gets called can be quite far in the future. And because I design all of Conjure's stuff to support synchronous things or asynchronous, like some messages are, like in the example of Fennel, this is instantaneous. Like it will block until it gets the result because it's all inside the same thread. Whereas if I go into like a racket RKT, I go in here and I eval something, like there's a delay here. So you can see I'm getting the one, I'm getting the result. Like it's all working, but it's having to send it out to, it sends the code to a subprocess, evaluates it, brings it back, displays it. Like there's a delay there. So I have to think about like where I'm jumping to, like the cursor from when I perform, when I start the eval to like when the eval comes back can be in a completely different place. And I need to work out, like I need to say, okay, well, given the original buffer, which I have, I don't think I need this. Yeah, I think I can get rid of the win. I don't need go to. What I'm doing is replacing the range. But it can't be a comment. It doesn't work like this. So in my buffer namespace, I have replace range. I kind of want a function that's like append comment or something, so I can put all the comment logic in. I'm just gonna do another tweet. Hang on. All right, so I can put all the comment in. Let's add some comments. Oh no. Oh no. I just want to share what I'm looking at. Okay, fine. So I think I want a function first. Like this, there's two problems here. This part is one thing. So let's do that and come at EC. So that's all good. The hard part is one of the hard parts is done. One of the hard parts is get the code, do the eval, get the result. Like that is a lot of moving parts to get to that point. And then the next step on from there, the next hard part is identify where the end of the form is. Go to the end of the line of the end of that form. Work out if there's a comment there already or not. If there is, then I want the next line. If there isn't, then I want to append to this line. So there's a bunch of logic there. So I think I want to do that in, what I call, it was buffer, Fennel. Yeah, so rather than replace range, we can have like append marker or something Because I don't want it to just be comments. It's not just comments. It appends something to the end of the line with a prefix on it. And those prefixes vary. So if I go to racket client, so here's the racket client source code. There you go, comment prefix. So this is the thing that modules expose, and all of them have these. So Janet, where's Janet's one? There you go, comment prefix. So this, the way this works is that it's going to support all of them straight away, because this thing is configured. Like, I can eval the file, and there you go, comment prefix. So sometimes the design of all this stuff makes me all warm and fuzzy inside. Maybe it's the coffee. What is this going to be? It's going to be like append suffix? Append, no, append prefixed. Prefixed suffix? I basically want a function that describes the act of, like, you know, putting something here or putting something here. I suppose I could call it append result. That's all it's going to be used for. Append prefixed result. Append prefixed result. Maybe that's good enough. Append prefixed. It all needs to fit on one line as well, is the other thing. Which is a fun one. Append prefix string, append prefixed. Smart append. Prefix smart append. It's smart because it behaves differently in different places. Another word for smart is dangerous and buggy. It's prefixed because it has to be given some prefix string to identify that thing. Like, is it a comment or not? Can I find that string? Oh, that's going to be really hard to identify. Oh, my. No, no. This is going to be so difficult. Oh, this is going to be so, so difficult. Because I won't know if the comment string is inside a string or not. So I'm going to be looking for like a semicolon. But what if it's this? Or, yeah, if it's that, then it will end up putting it on a new line. Oh no. So, I have a working theory. I can identify what syntax group something is in. And I might have to do that. Can I query through here? Buff and highlight. Buff get highlight by name. Name RGB. Gets a highlight definition by name. That is not what I want. Highlight group, no. No, there's no, okay, so there's no way to do that here. Interesting. So I can't just append a string. I need to look up whether it's a comment. So it's going to be comment specific. So this is going to be append. Yeah, it's going to be append comment. It's got to be. It has to know that it's a comment. Like, it has to be specific enough that it's kind of checking, does the line end in a comment highlight? Because I can check that. I don't know how exactly right now, but I can check that. And if the line ends in a comment, not that it's prefixed by this, then if it already ends in one, I'm going to add another one. And again, another one. Oh, that's a point. I think in SpaceMax or in Cider, they keep appending like this. So it kind of like drops lines and goes to the last one over and over. Oh, how's that gonna work? So I'd need to like hunt forward for a line that doesn't end in a comment and then append after that one. Oh, this just gets better and better, doesn't it? Okay, a way we can express that would be like a drop until final line of form, the original form, and then take the rest of them and then filter or find, no, sum. So find the first item, sum doesn't does not end in comment. And then that line that matches that one, that first line that isn't a comment that comes after the final line of the form, which would be here, would be our target. Well, isn't this just easy? And I think this becomes a general algorithm. So the way we identify what line we append the comment to is by, it's not always an append, is it? Sometimes you add after. This is quite something. I think the first thing I want to get working is this one, and then we'll work out the rest. Okay, baby steps, baby steps. I'm walking forward like multiple problems and thinking ahead quite deep, and I probably shouldn't be. So append comment. What's it gonna be? It's gonna be, we probably give it a line, right? Probably tell it where we want to append to. Eval. So what do I have? I have a range. So maybe I have a position. Yeah, so I have a position. So let's say like at pause or line. Yeah, line number. Target line. Target line. Let's go with target line because we don't know whether it's actually going to end up on there because of the way this thing works. Oh my God, that coffee is so good. I got it better than my first one today. I got the temperature just right. And it's 10 times better than the first cup. That is delicious. So we have a target line and we have a suffix, I guess. This is the thing we're going to append, right? Body? Let's go body. No. Yeah. It doesn't matter. It's identifiable. So we'll go with body. Don't know if that's big enough, whether anyone can even read that. And what are we going to do first? So if we have the target line number, we need the buffer as well. So we have a buff, a line, and a body. And buffers are just numbers, they're just IDs. So like when I say win get buff zero, that's get the buffer number of the current zero, and the buffer number is one. So, what do I want to do with this? I want to append to that line. So that's going to be. Do I have nvim in here? I do. Nvim dot get lines. Yes, there's get lines buff start line end line. Get lines buff. Start line will be target line. End line will be target line. Let's just give a line. No. Target line because we're probably going to name a bunch of variables line, to be honest. False is whether or not you want strict mode. Never really worried about it. Let's have a little test one here. So append comment buff is going to be zero for current buffer. Target line is going to be, I don't know, 57. How about, actually, let's put it up here, 54. 54. And the body is going to be hello wall, runtime error, attempt to call field, get lines a nil value. Get lines, buff get lines. All right. Alrighty, righty, righty. That's nothing. That's because these are zero indexed, or because this needs to be incremented. I think the target line needs to be one more. Okay, there we go. So we have the current line now being identified. So what can we do with that? Should I get this line until the end? Like if I do that, this is kind of the hunt. So the target line is the last line of the form, but we get all lines in the buffer. Yes, I'm liking this. This is beginning to click in my head. So we get the whole thing. This is really how I solve these problems. Like I start stepping towards the solution and things sort of fall into place as I go through interactive development. So I'm getting these lines. So that's fetching these. So from this position down to the bottom. And I love working on the thing I'm working on, like this cyclic way of working. I think is fun. What am I doing? Okay. I actually want to put on royalty-free chill hop. Oh no, actually, I don't have my desktop audio on, do I? I do not. I can put Spotify on. Gonna put on some music because you can't hear it and I can't get DMCA'd for it. If you are in the Conjured Discord, I could probably share music with you through there, but. Okay, cool. I have music now. So we are getting lines. Let's let this. Candidates. We don't know what they end in. We don't know whether they end in comments. Am I overthinking it? Is it that big of a deal if somebody has a comment in their string? I don't think it is. Append. Prefixed line. Yeah, I think I can do it like this. I'm gonna do it by string. I'm not gonna do it by highlight group. Nobody can stop me. As always. I tell myself that a lot with what's this? No, there. Yeah, there we go. Why don't you like that? Prefix body target line four. Okay. So we've got all of our lines. So what I'm going to look for is if let's give this as a position. So what is this? 53, and where does the form end? Let's say the form ends at 54. It doesn't really, but yeah, let's do this. Because it has to come after this. I think that makes it safe enough. So instead of target line, you got TL and TC. So target line, target column. So let's do TL. And let's say, can I do first and rest? I think I can. Head line and lines. Does that work? Uh-oh. It does not. What's this complaining about? Expected Lua number. Ah, that's what the ampersand is doing. Let's get the phenyl docs up. How do you express rest? Reference. Destructure. Is it dot dot dot? No, A, B, and C. Yeah, that is right. Then maybe something here is wrong. TLTC. Unless it doesn't like this. Why is it not happy? Lines. What part is it? If I raise this and do that, still not happy. Expected lower number. Ah. Wonder why. Why, oh, why, oh, why, oh, why, oh, why? Oh, it's the wrong append. I've changed the function name. You silly Billy. 50, yeah, 50, 54. Okay. All right, cool. So that is now getting one line too many. Why is that? I want that to include that line 53. Oh. Wonder why. So I'm two lines behind now. Well, that's highly confusing. Why is line 52 corresponding to 54 here? What if I do zero? Zero is not including that one. What? What, like minus one? What does minus one do? Minus one does nothing. Hang on. Hang on. This doesn't even include the first line. So what's going on? Why is this not getting all the lines? TL TL, TL. Oh, huge face palm. Huge face palm all across the sky because I'm destructuring it and I'm taking the rest. Of course it is. Oh, apparently I need more coffee. Or less coffee, maybe. Yeah. 53 corresponds to 54. Yeah. Okay. Right, because I can do this. Headline. Yeah, you see, yeah, there we go. There's the headline, and there's the... Oh, hang on, my ergodox. You see the red? One of my ergodoxes just died. Hang on. It does this. I never worked out what it was. I think it's a software glitch. Unplug it, plug it back in. Okay, so that's the rest of the lines. My attempt is going to be, can I put it on the end of this line? If I can, great. If not, I'll find one of these to put it on. Yeah. Okay. So ignoring the rest right now, all we're worried about is the headline or first line. So how's that going to work? That's going to be... I kind of need these to be indexed. Yeah, I kind of need to index these. So this would be like a dot... Don't I have a... I've got a function for this, right? Map indexed? Eh. It's not really a map indexed. What happens? Let's throw some science at the wall and see what sticks. What happens if I do a dot kv pairs on that list? Ah, ha, 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 ha. Okay. Well, that's fun. Some of my functions work far better than they have any right to. So if I do a dot KV pairs on here, then this becomes, it's always going to be one. Never mind, don't need to do that. So there's basically going to be a branch. There's going to be, if this first line so headline sub how I substring things, lua string slicing. How do I do this? There are all sorts of ways to do this. Nth head, are these real things? These aren't things. You're making that up. This is more like it. Sub, is it sub? G sub, replacing a substring. I would like a portion of a string, please. Ah, I'm going to find. Yeah, find main string, find string, start index. Yeah. So this is going to be a string find. Yeah. So headline find, main string find string. What am I looking for? I'm looking for the prefix. I'm looking for the prefix. And it must start after here. So it has to start after that closing paren. So if I can find that after there, it means, yep, got a comment. Or nope, don't have a comment. Let's do that. So nope. Yep. Yes, that is exactly what I want. So now it detects, basically. It won't detect it there, because it needs a space. So it's trying to detect a comment on the end of that first line. So if we have a comment on the end of the first line, we need to go into the more complex case, where we kind of like, maybe recursively? I don't think I can do it recursively. It could be fun. Basically, in this case, we don't have a comment on the end. It's the simple case. So I'm going to do a nvim.buff set lines, and it's going to be buff target line to a dot ink target line. So replace this line to here, so just this line, with and then set lines, set buff set lines. So it's from to strictness, and then the string. So this is just going to be headline plus a space plus a prefix plus the body, I think. We are cooking with gas. Okay, so that appends a comment onto this line. That's the easy case. I think I need that ink, but so then there's the hard case of I need to find how many line offset I need to go down before I can insert a line, because now it's not about appending, it's about inserting a new line. All right. What does that mean? So I think this is where I do a KV pairs on lines that gets me them indexed. And now it's a case of a.sum. I'm so glad I wrote all these functions. This is pretty nifty. So I have an n at the index of the line, which is kind of an offset, and I have the line itself. And then what I want to do is this same check. Instead, it's going to be, does it start with? So do I, is there a start with thing? Didn't I write something for that? I did. Good job, me. Starts with. And I have it already included. So text.starts with line prefix. So when that, when this, then come on brain, do your thing. This is what the coffee's, oh no, I'm almost out. No. I should probably just get like a coffee machine on my desk or something. That make life easier. So what am I going to return? I can return the n and the line here. So this finds the offset. So I can actually do, how about this? So plus TL, so target line plus n. And the line. I don't need the line at that point. All I need to do is find the target line. It's either this or minus one. Is it minus one to go to the end? Yes, it is. All right, so so that's currently saying minus one. That shouldn't be true. Maybe plus one. What I want it to do is to say, on this case where I already have a comment on the end, so there's already a comment on the end of this line, I want it to say, okay, well, instead of appending it to this line, add it here. And then I want it to work out in the next case, add it here. And then add it here. and just keep going. Oh, this is so close. I can smell it. So this is probably just gonna be like TL plus one, or maybe just TL plus TL one. I don't know. Which is actually a dot ink. Let's see what this does. So a dot ink. So it gives me 54. Right. So this function is gonna get messy, but so there's gonna be buff set lines. This is gonna be the way I get the target line. Let's do another let in here. Just bear with me. New TL, because it's gonna be a new line. New TL. So this is gonna be set lines. Oh, how's this gonna work? I have to splice them because I can't just insert a line. Oh no. Oh, my brain. Maybe I can, you know? Ooh. Okay. Things are clicking. I think. Ooh, what happened there? That bug? I think I found a bug in this S expression manipulation. So what I actually want to do, I don't want to just return the plus here. I want to return a few things. I want to return plus TL and N, and I want to return a new string, which is the line that I'm targeting plus the prefix and body. Let's name this one. To append is dot dot prefix body. Actually, let's do. Do I have string included? No. Str conjure aniseed string. I use this because it's safer. Str join that handles nils and that sort of thing properly. To append. To append. Sorry about the noise. So this is going to. Let's see what it does. Nothing. That's what it does. Because this is looking for. Oh, I'm a line off now. I increased the line count of the buffer. Right. So that is now saying if I need to replace line 55, which is offset by one, so this line. Replace that line with two lines, which includes a hello world and a foo. That is correct. The case I need it to handle is there's a comment at the end of this line. Tell me to put one in here, which is tell me to replace this line. Okay. So there's an or, and it's going to be. Plus TL. I have some nice rolling drum and bass on right now, but I can't play it without the FBI coming and arresting me now. To append? No? Yeah. It's this. No. Aha. That. All right, I think I'm getting somewhere. First line. Yeah. So what we end up getting back, if there's, in this case, where we have a comment on the end of the line, but we don't have anything else underneath it, so I want the next comment to appear here. This is going to return line 54. So this line, replace it with two lines, which will essentially insert one here. So then what we do is let this, and we just say new TL and lines is the result of this. Sometimes you just have to like let my mad science happen, and we'll see the result. I can barely keep up like or understand my code after I've written it. Like anything that involves working with Vim buffers and stuff is such a like back and forth tennis mess that it's really hard to succinctly write it. Especially since I have no functions for like replacing a line. You have to get the lines or as a table and then do some stuff to them and then put them back in the right place, replacing certain lines. It's not straightforward. So we do this. UTL, think, lines. Now, will that break everything? Oh. Okay. I'm pretty happy with this right now. So that goes there. Let's put two in here. Two, three, almost, almost. I want this to appear here under this line. Okay, oh, I've almost got it. We've almost got it. So we're doing a new TL. It's TL plus N. Maybe it needs to ink or to append needs to go here. Is that it? Maybe that's it. Hold up. Two, three, five. I want the last one. I don't want the first one. So how do I do that? That's gonna be filter last. Filter last, yeah. All right, so we thread this, grab this, do this, put that here, do that, change that to an A dot filter, do that, slap that, indent that, do that, go here, and A dot last, and join that, eval. Unexpected Lua table stack trace. Expected Lua table. That is because. Why is that? Ah, it's a keep. Do I don't have keep map a dot filter. What do I filter it to? I filter it to. Just kind of want a function that says like it's truthy. A dot filter fun x. Oh, identity. Ah, yeah. Okay, got a function. Ah, yeah. Yep. I think we're there. I think we're there. So, fresh eval puts it on the end. Number two puts it there. Number three puts it there. Number five puts it there. Number six puts it there. I We're done it. Although, okay, so there's one thing that could be funky. Let's see if it will do it. Yes. Okay. So I'm catching my own bugs early. That's good. All right. How do we make this not do that? How do we make it so here, not here, please? So I'm saying last here. Really, I want it to be. It's like I want the first match before something that doesn't match. Well, this is. Oh, I'm out of coffee. This is absolutely mind-bending, and I love it. This problem was far more interesting than I thought it was going to How do we do it? How do we do it? How do we do it? Because we're taking all of the lines, so that means all, ooh, all of these lines, we are mapping them when they start with the prefix. So when they start with this into something else. And then I'm filtering them and I'm taking the last one from that filter. Kind of want to take until. I want to take until. All right. Yeah. Do I have a take until? I don't think I do. I don't. Right? I don't have a take until. Damn it, pass me. Why didn't I write this function? I don't have a drop while. I'm gonna have to write that as a function. Oh, that's annoying. I didn't really want to have to. Because what do I want to express? I want take while a dot identity. Yeah, that is what I want. And then I take the last of the take while. All right, let's express it here first before I put this in aniseed, because this will be quite a generic thing. So defin take while, which takes f and xs, and what's it going to do? It's going to do. Do I do it recursively? No, I should do it manually. Screw it, recursive. We're going recursive. It has its limitations of stack size and everything, but screw it. So take while, and what are we going to do? We're going to do acc. Is there an accumulator? Let's have an internal function. Yeah, let's do it this way. So we're going to have a ooh, let rec, maybe? Doesn't really matter. F, which takes an accumulator. And then we call this rec with a table. And this thing will say when. When excess. Ah, no, I can't destroy it. I don't want to destroy this excess. I want to walk through it. I don't want to be destructive. So if I don't want to be destructive, I need to loop. Ah, that's annoying. Okay, so this means that I need a for loop. I can't remember how for loops work in Fennel. Do, 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 do. Aha! So for I, 10 2 step. So for I start at one because they're one indexed, a dot count xs, I wrote my own count function that just works better. Step one. And what's it gonna do? Let's a dot println a dot get. I'll say dot xs I. See what this does. Take while a dot identity 1, 2, 3, nil, 4, 5. Let's do false. So this prints everything. Cool. So we have 1, 2, 3, false, 4, 5 being printed. I want it to print. I want to get this as a list. So let's do var ack. It's going to be imperative because it's faster. How do I bail from a loop? Lua break from loop. How do you do it? Break statement. Can I do break? I don't think I can. I don't think that's a thing in Fennel. Skip, break. Next. No, these aren't things. That's fine. That's fine. So we're going to say when f of dot xs I. So when we get a result, some sort of truthy result, then table dot insert ack. Let's let this let v be that. Table dot insert ack v. It's an if. Otherwise, set done to true and not done. I don't know how to break, so I'm going to do it this way. Var done false. And then we return ack. Cool. That works how I expect. So it's still appending to the wrong place. Why is that? Was hoping that would do it, you know. Append prefix line, append prefix line. No. Maybe the nils don't. If that otherwise false, is it to do with Lua tables? It is. Yeah, Lua tables behave weird. A nil in a table counts as the end of the table. It's super strange. So I put a false there if it doesn't, if it's not real. Cool, I think we got it. This is going to make implementing the rest of the feature much easier. That is great. That works exactly as I want it to. All right, so with that beast of a function written, which definitely is completely correct and there are no bugs whatsoever. I can now go over to here and what do we do with this? What do we do with this? So rather than replacing the range now, I'm going to do text dot, wait, is it text buffer? Buffer dot append comment function we just wrote. Let me look at it so I know what happens. Oh, it's append prefix line. Yeah, buffer.append prefix line. Appends a string to the end of the current line or the one below this one if there's already the same suffix on the end already? No, oh. This is really hard to explain. Appends a string to the end of the current line or the one below this one if there's already the same suffix at the end. If there's a already a matching suffix on the end of this line and the one below, it will insert another below that last one and so on. Good enough. Just has to give a general hint of what's going on. That's all I care about. And what does it take? It takes, I have memory of a goldfish, buff TL, yeah, buff coordinate, so that's going to be end of, oh, can't do that. Dot range end, yeah. Let's use aniseeds get, because it's safer. Get range end. Actually, it's going to explode regardless if it doesn't have that. Range end. Prefix is comment prefix. This client get comment prefix. Let's grab this here because it might change. It's the thing, you can change clients, like from the start of the eval to when it finished, you could have hopped to a different buffer and a different client. So I need to handle that. There's like so much, the time that this callback is called could be a completely different world to when it was initially invoked. So you have a comment prefix and the body is, I think text dot, I kind of need to, so this is where it gets weird. Like, how do I just join it all onto one line? How does CIDR do that? Does CIDR, like, express the whole thing as multiple lines? Maybe it does, and that's how I should do it. Let's just stick it in first. I'll work that out later. Okay, so that's comment prefix. Comment form. Don't know why that put that there, one line off. I think my positions are off slightly. Deck that one, do that. No. No. Wait, no. Why are you, what? Oh, I'm doing the wrong one. You wally. So this, I think, I want to decrement a dot deck and leave that one standard. That replaced the whole thing. Not fantastic, I'll be honest. A dot ink. No. Oh no. Why isn't this working? Why? Unless this isn't working as I expect. I think it is. Why did it work in that other buffer? One, six, five. Let's see what this looks like. A dot println. One, six, six, eight. Right. Eight is here. Yeah. What's wrong with that? Interesting that it worked in this buffer and not in the other one. By interesting, I mean deeply frustrating. Why? Comment prefix result. Yeah. I wonder what lines I'm getting here. Let's print headline and lines. Oh, that's quite big. Oh. This is really weird. So the first line is definite word. What? Okay, something is very off. Like, it's not even getting the first line. It's just not there. So that means it's nil. What could that mean? Because it worked here, which is just weird. Like, where was my. Let's grab this. Put this back to how it was. Put this here. And line. What line did I say it was? 54? Was I incrementing this? I was, I think. Why is that appearing there? Is that line 54 now? Oh, yeah, that's line 54. So I want line 65. 65. That appends after it. Cool. Let's get rid of these prints. They're not helping. Okay, so this has kind of reproduced it, right? Like, yeah, this is reproducing. This is printing here. I need this to be line 64. Like, one before it. And then it works. So I think I'm just off by one line, you know? I think something is off by one line. I think this TL needs to be decremented by one. Basically, at all times. Let's just TL is a dot dec TL. Why not? Oh, not that one. That one. Does this still work as expected? Yes, it does. Okay. Now, in the real world scenario. Aha! Ha ha ha! And then increment this. All right, we're cooking with gas. What happens if I eval this whole thing? Something didn't like that. Because nothing was appended. What about this? Huh. Okay, so that appears there, but this one doesn't show anything. Like, if it has new lines in it, it just doesn't display. I wonder why. It's probably throwing errors, you know. I bet it's throwing errors. Yeah, string cannot contain new lines. Okay, right. Right, 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 right. So the next thing to work out is... So we've got those working. How do I make something that contains new lines display? So foo / n bar. Doesn't do anything. Throws an error right now. So lines. So it's the body. This instead will be. So to append is basically going to become a chunk of lines. So this is going to become a dot concat of that and that. Yeah. And the same with this one. A dot concat. And this one is going to be. Oh boy. That one. Oh, that one gets a little trickier. A dot first to append. Hang on, concat. Hang on. Whoa. Accidentally flinging my cursor. A dot rest to append. Okay, so that's all of those now dealing in lists or tables. My brain. This is now, instead of string.join, it is str.map, no, a.map, a.map body to fun body line, and let's do s, dot dot, prefix s. Oh no, I have a function for this. Text up prefix lines? I have a function for this. Which, how does it work? Prefix lines. Takes s prefix and opts. Body prefix. I don't think I have any opts. Oh my god. All right. I'm sorry. I'm absolutely shocked that that just worked. Oh, that's great. All right, sure. Yeah, cool. Why not? And then let's just change the logic here. So if a.count equals one of to append. So if there's only one line, let's simplify it and say it's just the headline and that. Otherwise, it's just a concat. So this way, yeah, let's do it like this. Compile error. Unknown global in strict mode conjure. Well, that's unfortunate, isn't it? Add up first to append. What's wrong with that? Oh, I was trying to evaluate a thing that couldn't be evaluated. So now, if you evaluate a multi-line form, it comments the entire thing and appends it after your line. And it will go, if you do it again, it will go down here and find the first line that isn't a comment and append it again. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty happy with that. That's rather neat. If I do this, pens it on the end, again, 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 again. All right, that is great. I think I'm probably going to wrap up with that. I don't know if I'm going to release it yet. I think I'll create a demo clip and get some people to use it before I release it, because this could be horribly broken. Like, look how much code I just wrote. Like, this is rightly so, quite a complex beast. I can't really make that any simpler. Apart from, it's nice that the comment form one, like, this is quite simple and expressive. It's just like, get me the code, eval the code, add it to the end of the line, and all of the clever logic about appending stuff is all in here. And the neat thing is, one of the neat things is, hang on, I can go into a racket file and do this, and it works the same. Like, it's just, it just works. Interesting that that has, oh, if it contains a comment, if the result is a comment, that's interesting. Right, let's commit this. Let's give it a full compile. Tests passed. Good. Make sure I can just eval some stuff still. Yeah, I can't do that. Do that. Oh my, that's so good. Oh, I'm so happy with it. Oh, that's interesting. Oh no, it did put it in the right place. Yeah. Right. I am a happy bunny about that. Let's check the diff. So buffer config. Yep, that. My watch is telling me to get up and walk around, which I will do. Let's document this thing. Conjure txt. Eval marked. Copy this. Eval comment form. Yeah. Evaluates the form under the cursor, so you see, and displays the result at the end of the current line or below the current line as a comment. What you think? Evaluates the form under the cursor and displays the result as a comment at the end of the current line or below the current line. I think that's good. Let's just search for marked. Mapping eval mark form. Oh, that's not what I was looking for. Do I not have another? Yeah, mark. So then local leader. These are the defaults. EC evaluate. It's the form under the cursor and displays the result as a comment at the end of the line or below the current line if you already have a comment there. Nope, that's not what I wanted, Vim. Thank you. GQ. Ah! One wrong button, and you are all over the place. Evaluates the form under the cursor and displays the result as a comment at the end of the line or below the current line if you already have a comment there. Now, I should really add this to the school as well. But I'm not going to do that just yet because it's kind of a more advanced thing, and changing the school takes more time. And also, if I got rid of the feature, I'd be kind of wasting a lot of time there. So, let's just make this again, make sure it's all good. Commit. Let's not commit through here. Let's commit through here. So, add eval comment mapping closes 160. All right. Push, 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 push. Let's make a little a skinema, shall we? So let me go /dev/closure/ripple/cider. We'll get a REPL up. Put that on another desktop. A skinema. What's this going to be? Conjure eval into comment. Eval results into comments. Yeah. Go to a sandbox. Connect to a session. Eval into a comment. What else do we show? That'll do. And let's go tweet this. I just pushed eval into a comment at the end of the line. Catchy. To the develop branch of Conjure. Please do check it out and let me know what you think. And then let's go to Clojurians. Just share this around. And Discord. As well. Conjure, 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 conjure. Bump. And conjure. Let's put it in dev. This works in every client and language. All right. I think that's good for today. I will cut a release if we are happy. If things are looking good, probably at the end of the weekend, maybe tomorrow. We'll see. And I'll cut a release out because this has been pretty productive and successful. And even if nobody really commented or watched, it's still, I don't know, a motivating factor. Like, helps me focus. I can't slack off and go on Reddit, like, if there might be some people watching. Just the possibility. But I think I will leave that there. That's enough code change for today. That's 3 hours of streaming. I'm gonna go do some lunch and then play some video games. So thank you very much, anyone that did watch. I will happily do this again if people find it interesting. If not, no problem. Not a big deal. I hope you all have a great day ahead of you. And yeah, have a good one. Speak to you later. Bye bye.